Thank you. It's so great to be with you this morning. As Anthony mentioned, I work for an organization called Wellsprings of Freedom International. And Wellsprings exists to help wounded, tormented, and spiritually oppressed individuals find freedom, hope, and restoration through Jesus Christ. And so I enjoy being able to do these types of things on a regular basis. It tends to be because there's a spiritual warfare element to what Wellsprings does. Right around Halloween time, I'm often asked to speak somewhere on the topic of spiritual warfare, and so I'm glad today to have that opportunity to do that here. Halloween is, in fact, today, and in our culture, this is a day where there's the fun of dressing up and going door-to-door to get candy, and I got to say, I like the candy part of this. You know, the candy's all right. Churches will do trunk-or-treat events to try to connect with communities and all of that, but there's also that dark side of everything. There's the creepy stories and the creepy yard decorations and the scary movies and kind of the celebration of everything that's just dark and evil. Pastor Tim Howard, who is the founder of Wellsprings of Freedom International, he and I had the privilege of writing a four-week Bible study on spiritual warfare called Collision, Kingdoms in Conflict. And in that Bible study, he pointed out that our society is increasingly fascinated with dark spirit realm realities, things like fortune tellers, channeling, witchcraft, new age practices, spirit guides, etc. And unfortunately, at the same time, in many cases, the church has drifted into a fog of disbelief over any discussion about deeper levels of spiritual warfare. The idea of Satan and demons existing or having the ability to affect believers is often dismissed as heretical or on the same level as folklore, much like those spooky stories that are told at Halloween. And so our culture says it's all just fun and games, and unfortunately some of the church doesn't realize the reality of these things as well and the way it can affect even us as believers. When I was 12 years old, I lived in Florida at the time, and I went to a small Christian school there, and I had every Friday we'd have a chapel service where one of the pastors from one of the churches in the community would come in and share with the students. And on this particular chapel service, I remember when I was 12 years old, I don't think I'll ever forget it because it scared me so much, but I was in this service, and the pastor came. It was around Halloween time, and he had brought a cassette tape, so that dates it a little bit, shows you how long ago this was, but he brought a cassette tape of a radio broadcast that had just recently happened. And the backstory to this broadcast was apparently that there were these people involved in Satanism, and they were getting ready to do these rituals around Halloween time, and this girl was calling in asking for help. It was her parents involved in these things. And over the course of the broadcast, this person on the radio, on this recording we're listening to, tried to cast a demon out of this girl on the radio. And I just remember that what was once a girl's voice was suddenly a man's voice. And it just freaked me out as a 12-year-old. Now, the message of the speaker that day was, if you're a Christian, good news, you don't have to worry about it. Because the Holy Spirit lives inside of you, and so demonic forces aren't willing to come anywhere near you. So that's the good news. And that day, then he had an altar call, and I think half of the school was saved that day, you know, trying to avoid any kind of interaction with something like that. And so, at the same time, I also attended a church where we had a lot of former missionaries who would tell us stories of things that happened overseas, a lot of miraculous things, encounters with people who were demonized at times, and even talk about having to cast demons out of people. So from that, I kind of came up with some misconceptions in my mind that I think a lot of people in the church have. One of those misconceptions was that, well, if I'm a Christian, my body's the temple of the Holy Spirit, I've got the Holy Spirit living in me, I don't need to worry about any of that stuff, it can't come near me. But the other was, if it does happen, it also doesn't happen in the good old U.S. of A. That happens overseas. It's not something we have to worry about here. In the church, there tends to be two extreme positions on spiritual warfare and Satan and demons. At one end, the one extreme is to underestimate the power of demons and Satan, and even, to some extent, to deny their very existence. On the other extreme is to overestimate their power and to attribute every bad thing that happens to demons and Satan. In the book, the Screwtape Letters by C.S. Lewis, he says there are two equal and opposite errors into which our race can fall about the devil. One is to disbelieve in their existence. The other is to believe and to feel an excessive or unhealthy interest in them. They themselves, the demons, are equally pleased by both arrows and will hail a materialist or a magician with the same delight. In other words, we don't want to fall into either of the extremes. We need to have a more biblically based worldview. And the Bible will recognize that these things are real, that they exist, but it also doesn't attribute all the power of things to them. In fact, all the power ultimately is God. He is infinite. And so today, as we're talking here, I'd like to talk a little bit more about what the Bible does say about spiritual warfare. I'd also, though, I don't want this to be a lecture on spiritual warfare. I want to talk about how it affects us as believers. What does that really look like? And then how do we have victory in Christ? What does victory look like in our lives and how we're fighting from the winning side? Now, in the Bible, Satan is presented as a very real being. In fact, Heather was talking about these creatures in Revelation just a moment ago that we read about that have six wings, eyes all over their bodies, that describes them as a face of an eagle and an ox and a cow and all these interesting things. We see them presented several times throughout Scripture. We see them in Ezekiel. We see them in Isaiah. And in some of those other passages, it actually refers to them as cherubim. We think of baby angels sometimes from cartoons when we think of cherubim, but that's not what cherubim are in Scripture. They are something that is in the very throne room of God, giving praise to God, just like we saw in the Revelation passage. And in fact, in Ezekiel 28, it's talking to the king of Tyre, but it's comparing him to Satan. And it talks about Satan being a guardian cherub in the Garden of Eden. He was present in the Garden of Eden. So he was one of these fantastic, amazing spiritual beings. And we see we were reading that today in Revelation 4, just a few chapters later in Revelation 12. It actually talks about a historic event that happened in heaven. It says, then war broke out in heaven. Michael, who was one of these powerful angelic beings, and his angels, so he had a following of angels helping him, fought against the dragon. And the dragon and his angels fought back. But he was not strong enough, and they lost their place in heaven. The great dragon was hurled down, the ancient serpent called the devil, or Satan, who leads the whole world astray. He was hurled to the earth, and his angels with him. In fact, in Luke chapter 10, verses 18 and 19, Jesus talking to his followers mentions the same event. He says, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. So biblically speaking, Satan is a very real being. He's one who lost his place in heaven. He had a following of angels who also lost their place in heaven. And they were cast down to the earth, and they live in rebellion to God to this day. However, there's good news in this. In fact, there's good news in the passage I just read. If you heard it, in Revelation 12:8, right there, it says of Satan, the dragon, he was not strong enough. Which I love that verse, because it points to the fact that unlike God, Satan is not all-powerful. He is limited in his power. He's a limited created being, and God is all-powerful, which means that we're on the winning side. Timothy Keller correctly noted, Satan is a fallen angel leading fallen angels, but God is infinitely more powerful. Now, not only is Satan not like God in being all-powerful, but he's also, as Anthony was talking about at the beginning, he's not omnipresent. He's not everywhere at once like God is. In fact, you can see that in the book of Job, in the very first chapter of the book of Job, in verse 7, there's this account of this heavenly court gathering together before God, and these angels are gathering there, and among them, Satan also comes. And in verse 4, God asks Satan, where have you come from? And Satan answers, from roaming throughout the earth, going back and forth in it. In other words, Satan's not everywhere at once. He's roaming. He's moving around. He's on the earth. He's in one place at a time. In fact, Peter talks about this in 1 Peter 5:8. He says, be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. So Satan is present on the earth, but he's not all present. He roams around. Another way in which Satan is not like God is he's not all-knowing. He doesn't know everything like God does. And in fact, back in the first chapter of Job again, in verse 8, God is talking to Satan about a man named Job, and he says, there is no one on the earth like him. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil. Well, Satan retorts back right away in verse 11, saying, "But now stretch out your hand and strike him and take away everything he owns, and he will surely curse you to your face." So what God does is he allows Satan to do that. He allows him to strike Job, to take away everything he owns. And it says just a few verses later in verse 22 that in all of this, Job did not sin by charging God with wrongdoing. In other words, Satan was wrong. God was right. He knew Job, and Satan was wrong about Job. Satan is not all-knowing. He doesn't know everything like God does. Now, the same is true of Satan, that he's limited in his knowledge and his power and his presence, unlike God. The same is true of those angels that were following him and were cast to the earth that we know as demons. In fact, demons as well are presented as very real in Scripture. They're mentioned over 100 times, affirming their reality. It's also good to note that it makes sense that if Satan can't be everywhere at once, it makes sense that he would need a following of fallen angels to help him in his rebellion against God worldwide, because he can't be everywhere at once. And so we see biblically the reality of these things, but then the question comes up, well, what does that mean for us as believers? That chapel speaker that I had when I was 12 years old, was he just completely wrong? Do we really need to be, like, fearful of this, that we're going to suddenly be talking in someone else's voice? Or what does this all mean for us? Should we be afraid to approach these things? Well, what does the Bible say? There's a key passage on this in Ephesians 6. And in verses 10 through 12 of Ephesians 6, Paul says, "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places," or in the heavenly realms. Now, when I would read that before, I would wonder, who really is Paul talking about? He talks about the rulers, the powers, the authorities. Clinton Arnold, in a book, Three Crucial Questions About Spiritual Warfare, he does a good job of actually digging into the original language, the Greek language that Paul was using here. And he breaks down all of the terms used there. I'm not going to take time to do that today for sake of time. But all of those terms that Paul is using are terms that are used by ancient Jews, by the Greeks, to describe demonic powers. It's not just talking about world leaders and governors and presidents and things like that. It would be demonic powers. That's why the New Living Translation gets verse 12 a little more right when it translates it saying, "For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places." And an important thing to remember about Ephesians is Paul is writing this letter to believers in the church of Ephesus. So he's saying to Christians that as Christians, our struggle is also against these dark spiritual realities. There is an effect upon us Christians, and he goes on then to say that we need to put on the full armor of God in that battle against the enemy. And in fact, in verse 13, where he starts about that, in verse 16, he talks about one of those pieces of armor is the shield of faith. Our faith acts like a shield. And he tells us to take up the shield of faith to extinguish the flaming arrows of the evil one. Now, why would we as Christians be asked to take up a shield if we could not come under attack? And so Paul is pointing out that we do, as believers, sometimes come under demonic attack. At the same time, we're not to be afraid of that. In the same passage there where Peter mentioned about the devil roaming the earth, looking for someone to devour in 1 Peter 5:8. Notice that he didn't start off there by saying, "Be afraid. The devil is roaming around looking for someone to devour." No, he started off actually saying, "Be alert and of sober mind. The devil is roaming around." So we are, as believers, to be alert and aware of these things, but we're not to live in fear of these things. In fact, a few verses later in Romans 8:31, Paul says, "What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us?" And then in verses 37 and 38 of the same chapter, he adds, "No, in all of this, we are more than conquerors. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus." Jesus as well said to his followers back in Luke 10, 19 through 20, he said of the demonic forces, "I have given," or said to his followers about demons, I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions. Now, keep in mind here, context is talking about dark spiritual realities when he refers to these snakes and scorpions. And he says, I've given you the authority to trample on them and to overcome the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. So the point is our relationship with Christ. That's where our focus should be. And as a result of that, we as his followers have his spirit within us. We share the authority of Christ in us. We have authority over these things. In fact, James backs that up too in the book of James chapter 4. He doesn't tell us to run afraid from Satan, but rather he says in James 4:7, submit yourselves then to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. And so we are on the winning side. So then practically speaking, what does this look like? What does it look like when Christians come under attack? Was my chapel speaker completely right that we don't have to worry about it because they're not going to come near us? Or is there an element that we can be affected? If it's not possession, then what is it? Where is the confusion here? The truth is that biblically speaking, we as Christians can't be possessed by a demon because possession in our language implies ownership. If I possess a car, I own that car. I can ride and drive around in that car. It's my car. If I possess a house, I live in the house. So possession in our language implies ownership. And 2 Peter 2:9, for example, says that you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you can declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. So we are possessed, owned by God as believers. We've given our lives to him. He's the one who is in charge of our lives and who dwells within us. However, we've also said we can come under demonic attack. So how do we rectify that? How do we understand it? Well, part of it is in our translation in the English language. Whenever scholars in the past, starting with King James and on, when they would translate into English, they would see this word in the Greek language called daimonizomai, and they already knew we were familiar with the concept of demon possession. So they would just translate daimonizomai as demon possessed. And throughout our English translations, that's how it plays out. But most scholars would agree that the original word daimonizomai is better to be translated as has a demon. Or in other words, can be demonized or be subject to demonic influence or varying degrees of demonic control. In other words, there is a spectrum to this word. It's not all like the Gerasene demoniac. You've got a legion of demons speaking out of them. But rather, demonic oppression, even like Paul is talking about in Ephesians 6, can refer to this same thing. So under that term that Paul would have known and the Greeks would have used, we as Christians can come under some level of demonization, even if it's not as extreme as some of the cases that we hear. In fact, to illustrate this, Robert Munger wrote a book a long time ago called My Heart's Christ Throne. And in that, he's talking about how we grow as believers, how we grow in our faith. And he talks about when we first become a Christian, Jesus moves into our hearts, and our hearts are like his home. He takes possession of it, and he moves in. He's got full reign of the living room, of the kitchen. But there tend to be those back hallways that we don't want to let him into. There's the back bedroom, there's that bathroom, there's that smelly closet in the kitchen we don't want him to find, we don't want him to go into. And part of our life of growing as Christians is to surrender those areas of our lives, to let him in, to let him clean them up. But until we do that, it's as if those places are still places the enemy can hide out and have their way in the things that we're doing. In fact, this concept isn't foreign from Scripture either. In Ephesians 4, 26 and 27, Paul says, in your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. Now, in the original Greek language, Trent Marnold again described that word foothold. And that word is topos. And topos can also be interpreted as an inhabitable space. So in other words, what Paul is saying is, in your anger, don't sin. Don't let the sun go down while you're angry. Don't give the devil an inhabitable space in your life, that foothold in your life. And he's again writing this to believers in Ephesus. So when we think of demons and their interactions with us, unfortunately, we're very informed by Hollywood. We think again of the creepy yard decorations and the scary stories and Hollywood's presentation, people's heads spinning and all of that. I think of that cassette tape I heard when I was 12 years old of that girl talking And it can be a very kind of scary thought. But the reality is that as believers, we're usually not attacked from the inside out by demonic forces, but rather from the outside in. Demons are projecting thoughts into our minds, and they're telling us lies, and they're trying to lead us astray with temptations and so forth. Dr. Johannes Reimer noted that we as believers often hear three voices in our heads. We hear the voice of God, we hear our own thought voice, and we hear the voice of the enemy. And sometimes, honestly, it's hard to tell the difference. Sometimes it just sounds like it's all our own thought, positive or negative, and it's hard to distinguish the difference. That's why Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians 10:5 to take every thought captive and submit it to Christ, because we can certainly be attacked by the enemy, even as believers, in our thought life and the things that come into our minds, the lies that we hear. We can also come under attack in other ways. It is possible to come under some types of physical attack. We tend to dismiss that off post-enlightenment. We focus on science and medicine, but even in Scripture, there are times where demons are attributed as affecting the physical body. For example, Mark chapter 9, verse 25, he casts a demon out of a boy who is deaf and mute. He calls it a deaf and mute spirit. And then the boy could hear and he could talk, and he even had seizures as a result of it. Even in Luke 13, verse 11, it talks about a woman in the synagogue. It refers to her as the daughter of Abraham. In other words, she was a devout follower of God who was worshiping in the synagogue, and Jesus was there. And he said of her in Luke 13, 11, that she was crippled by an evil spirit and had been crippled by an evil spirit for 18 years. And then he cast it out of her and heals her. Of course, he gets in trouble for doing it on the Sabbath. But that's in Luke 13. So there are some biblical backings for ways that we can be attacked other than just our minds. It could be illnesses and things like that. In 20 years of freedom ministry, Wellsprings of Freedom International has been able to identify some common symptoms of demonic attacks on believers, what that looks like, and what are some of the common symptoms. Now, the list I'm going to share is not an exhaustive list, but here are some things we have seen over the years, believers experiencing that's a red flag and says there may be a spiritual warfare element to this. Constant or uncontrollable anger or rage, feelings of hopelessness and helplessness, persistent negative self-talk, or struggles with fear and anxiety and depression and gloom, self-hatred, low self-esteem, or feelings of unworthiness, suicidal thoughts, addictions, or obsessive and compulsive behaviors, deep-seated bitterness, resentment, or unforgiveness, or feelings of abandonment, rejection, guilt, and shame. They can be racing and chaotic thoughts and negative thoughts. There can be times of sleeplessness and nightmares. There can be physical problems such as headaches or illnesses. Now, as I read that list, no doubt, as you're sitting there, some of you are like, yeah, I've had that. I had one person say after me talking one time, I think I had everything on the list, right? And we need to remember where I started this talk. There are two extreme views, all right? When I read a list like this, it's tempting to think, man, everything, the demons are behind everything. There's a demon behind every bush. We're overestimating the power of the enemy and blaming everything on demons. At the same time, we need to avoid completely ignoring them as part of the problem as well. We don't want to underestimate their power. So how do we find middle ground there? Dr. Charles Kraft, who is a professor emeritus of Fuller Theological Seminary, he shares this helpful analogy. He says, where you see garbage piling up, you'll often find it's infested with rats. Rats will move in and infest that garbage. Well, in our lives, the things we experience, there are real medical issues. There are real psychological problems. There are things that are done to us and things we do to others and sins we get involved in and addictions and all that stuff. That stuff starts to pile up in us like a bunch of garbage in these back rooms, right? And that's where the enemy says, I'm going to capitalize on that. They start to infest that garbage like the rats. They come in and start telling us lies and telling us things about ourselves that aren't true and trying to make us believe that we're not worthy and we're not loved and all these things. And so where the garbage is, the rats are often found. So that's why we say when we see these things, it's often a red flag when we pay attention and say, hey, there may be more to this than just the physical, just the mental. Where's the enemy involved in this as well? And that can help bring even deeper freedom in the life of a Christian. So we need to find that middle ground. The good news is we are on the winning side. We're not losing. We as believers, even though it doesn't always feel like it, are really fighting from a place of victory. So we're fighting from victory, not for victory. We've already been given victory in Christ. In Revelation, Satan was cast out. He's not as powerful. So how do we do that? How do we live in that victory that's been granted to us? One way that the enemy attacks us, as I mentioned, is in our minds. My team and I were leading a what we call a freedom session. It's a three-hour session that we do at Wellsprings where somebody will come in, they'll meet with our team, and we'll help them to discern what kind of attacks are they under, what in their life is going on that they need help with. And one woman came in to meet with our team, and at the beginning of the session, I asked her, what would you like God to do for you in our time together? And this is what she said. She said, I don't trust anyone. I judge people. I'm afraid. I'm always angry, and I speak harshly to those around me. This is a Christian woman. I don't fit in, but rather I'm often an outcast. I have to search for friendships, but no one searches for me. I'm alone. I have no abilities, and I fail at everything I do. What you wanted God to do was fix that. There's a lot of stuff. And you could just hear the lies coming into her mind. Well, later in the session, as we have moved through our time with her, I asked her, who are you? What identifies you? And getting an idea for what I wanted during that session, she said, well, I'm a daughter of God. I'm saved. He loves me. Which was a good answer. And I told her it was a good answer, but I lovingly told her it was a good Sunday school answer. Because the real answer, the one she really felt, was what she had revealed at the beginning of the session when I asked her what she wanted God to do for her. And she listed all those things. And we had to help her see the way the enemy was telling her lies about who she was. And until she could really accept who God said she was and come into that truth, she's going to keep believing those lies and not find that freedom that she was looking for. As you're sitting there, I am sure many of you have heard some of the same types of lies. You're not worthy. You're not loved. You've gone too far and all those types of things that the enemy will tell us in our minds. But what does Scripture say about you? Who are you according to Scripture? Let me remind you, sitting here today as believers, who you are. One, you are God's child. It says that in Galatians 3:26, John 1:12, 1 John 3, verse 1. It says that you are, God loved you even when you were still a sinner, says that in Romans 5:8. He loved you before you loved him, says that in 1 John 4:19. No matter how bad you've messed up, there is forgiveness because Jesus is your advocate. It says that in 1 John 1:9 and 1 John 2:1. You were created by him, saved by his grace, not by your works. It's not what you did. And it's by his grace that you've been seated with Christ in the heavenly realms. That's Ephesians 2:6-10. In fact, the Spirit of God, who raised Jesus from the dead, lives in you, says in Romans 8:11. There is no condemnation for you. God is for you. That's in Romans 8, verse 1 and in verse 31. You're not a slave to sin or to the enemy. You are his child. You're co-heirs with Christ. That's in Romans 8, 12-17. You have authority over the enemy in Christ. That's in Luke 10, 19 and 20. So it's important to remember those truths about you as you're thinking about these spiritual warfare ideas and what the enemy might be saying. Don't forget who you are. Remember what Scripture says about you. How do we do this practically? How do we practically fight the lies the enemy is telling us? First of all, close any open doors in your life you have to the enemy. In other words, seal off those inhabitable spaces in your life. If there is a willful sin that you know you've committed, confess it. 1 John 1:9 says, if you confess your sins, he's faithful and just, he'll forgive your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. There is forgiveness, so confess it. Another thing to do is stop doing it. Don't keep doing it. That's called repentance in Scripture. Acts 3:19 says, repent then and turn to God so that times of refreshing can come from the Lord. So stop doing it. Now, if you've struggled with an addiction and somebody's saying, just stop doing it, that's not as easy to do as it sounds. Addiction creates difficulty. And so sometimes we need to bring others around us. So if addiction is something that's got you, then bring in reinforcements as well. Involve community and get into some counseling for that. Or join a 12-step group like Celebrate Recovery or get involved in an accountability group or do all the above. But do whatever it takes to shut that door to the enemy. If something was done to you or if you've done something to someone else, then there's likely going to be some forgiveness needed. You need to forgive the one who harmed you. You might need to forgive yourself. Forgiveness is not saying what they did is okay, but rather it's recognizing the debt, canceling the debt, and releasing your right to revenge and to anger at them, at yourself, whoever the case may be. In fact, there's the old saying, holding on to unforgiveness is like drinking poison, hoping the other person dies. It's really only hurting you. It's not hurting them. So forgiveness is something to work through. And again, in 2 Corinthians 10:5, Paul says, take every thought captive. Well, how do you do that? Well, ask yourself, what emotions are dominating you? Are you always angry? Are you always anxious? Are you always depressed? What's dominating you? And what lies are accompanying those emotions? What thoughts are coming into your head? You might be hearing things like, you'll never be able to change. God has given up on you. You're not enough. You can't do what God is calling you to do. You failed. You can't live in a way that's pleasing to God. You've tried that too, and it hasn't worked. You're too broken. You should be ashamed of yourself. You should just give up. And on the list goes. You know the lies I'm talking about, right? I have those two at times. Craig Rochelle, in his book, Winning the War in Your Mind, he makes a helpful suggestion of an exercise to do to deal with some of that. He says, list out the lies. Write them down on paper. Listen to what you're hearing throughout the day. Write it down. The next to the lies, find scriptures that counteract what those lies are. In Ephesians 6, the sword of the Spirit is the word of God. Use that. And write down what those things are that are true about it. And then out of that, write a truth declaration that includes some of the thoughts from that verse. And then he says, every day, write it, think it, confess it, till you believe it. Start taking back over the mind where those lies are coming in. But here's the deal. Here's what I also know. Some of you are sitting there thinking, yes, David, good talk so far, but you haven't told us anything we didn't already know. I've tried this. I've done the sermons. I've even done accountability groups. I've done what I can to try to make the lies stop. And honestly, some of those lies sound true to me, and I'm not really even sure if it's God's voice, the enemy's voice, or my voice anymore. And doing these things, I'm still stuck. This isn't working for me. In the spring of 2020, right as the COVID pandemic was really hitting hard, Pastor Nick Beach of the Kentwood Community Church in Grand Rapids, Michigan, was doing a live broadcast on social media each morning called Tea Time with Mick. I think he still does it, and I've watched some of his episodes. Well, in the April 24, 2020 video, he talked about this biblical idea of taking every thought captive. And just like I just did, he gave some helpful tips, some ways that we can do that. But then he said this. He said, maybe you're experiencing the more severe issues of a thought life. That's when you bring the brother and the sister around you. You bring a team around you. You become humble. And you stop isolating yourself. And then that team begins to pray with you about that thought, about that hurt, about that sin, about that pain, so that they can discern with you what the Holy Spirit is saying and help you be delivered. They could stand with you. They could encourage you. He went on to say, if we began to practice this, I believe there would be more people delivered. And he's right. The reality is that we as believers were created for community. We weren't meant to do this all on our own. We're supposed to stay within the flock. We're supposed to help each other. The body of Christ should be coming around us to help us in these times. We need to be able to be open and willing to find help. As we finish up here, I want to tell you a little of my own story. I was, in 2006, I totally lost my mind, like literally lost it, to the point that I had to go to the hospital, and I was admitted to the hospital, and doctors were trying to figure out what had happened to my broken mind. Why did he lose his mind? They discovered that I had a rare form of sleep apnea. I'd had it for about 12 years, or 10 years, they figured out. And I had lost enough oxygen in my sleep every night for a decade that I actually suffered irreparable brain damage. And I lost the ability to control my emotions. And they said, the bad news is this is going to probably just get worse because there's no cure for your condition. And it did get worse. My kidneys ended up being damaged too. I only had 29% kidney function. In the worst days, I only had 10 minutes of memory at a time. I did completely lose the ability to control my emotions. I found myself in the hospital, suicidal. My marriage was falling apart because my wife no longer had a husband. She had a mental patient, two small kids she's trying to take care of, and I thought the best way to fix this is just take myself out of the picture. I was at a sporting event, and a friend was with me and introduced me to their pastor, and they said, you ought to tell my pastor what you've been going through. And I said, okay. So I told him, and he said, I believe if I pray for you, God will heal you. And I thought, well, that's cute. You know, I really, by that time, so many people had prayed for me, and I told him that. I said, you know what? A lot of people have prayed for me, and I've not been healed. I believe God could heal me, but I don't believe He will, because He hasn't. He said, I think He will. Let me pray for you. So He prayed for me. And to my amazement, to the amazement of my wife and my family, to the amazement of the doctors, I was healed of all of it. They said, no more brain damage, no more kidney damage. I didn't even have the breathing disorder. And they said, the doctor said, we can't explain this. It could only be a miracle that let this happen. Prior to this, when I was 17 years old, I had gone through some hurts in my life. And during that time, I had picked up an addiction. So when I was healed, which was 14 years ago, I said, you know, Lord, I still have this addiction. You heal all this other stuff. Why not heal the addiction? That's the part that you don't like. Why not get rid of that? And I felt like he was saying to me, hey, David, you picked that up. I need you to put that down. And there's a process to that. So I started that process. Like I said earlier, I got involved in 12-step groups. I got involved in counseling. I got involved in accountability groups. And those things helped to a degree, but I was still really struggling. And it was when a pastor at my church came up and said, hey, we've got these people that will meet with you. They're trained to do this. They'll sit down with you. They'll do exactly what Nick Veach said in that thing that I read you. They'll sit with you. They'll listen to you. Would you like me to sign you up? I said, sure. So I went with them for 3 hours. It was a Wellsprings team at our church. And they did that for 3 hours. They listened to me. They helped me realize, I have been believing the lie. You're too far gone. God's given up on you. You can't beat this thing. You haven't been able to do it so far. And they were able to pray prayers over me. They were able to help me see the truth in ways I couldn't do it on my own. And that was the point. I needed the body of Christ to come around with the giftings that they had and help me. So wherever you are today in this process, the thing to know is Jesus still is on your side. He still loves you. And he offers victory. And there really is victory for you. One of the things the enemy wants you to think is you don't have authority. There is no victory. You've already lost. And I'm here telling you, you already won. So if you need to, do what I did. Humble yourself. Get the body of Christ around you. Reach out to the pastor, to friends, or even come see us for a Wellsprings session if you need to. But there is hope in Christ. There is healing. And you have that today. So if he does believe in you, he's for you, he loves you. And I want you to take that with you today.